able to help me. He's Wallis Professor of Mathematics at Oxford. He's also the director of Oxford Mann Institute. He's the president of the London Mathematical Society. He's fellow of many royal societies. He has won many prizes, I won't tell you all of them. But he's also the father founding of the theory of rough paths. So, well, you probably know that Martin Heyer got the Fields Medal last year, and his work is essentially based on the rough path theory, which is due to Terry. So it's a great pleasure to have you today. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you all very much for coming, and I hope that what I have to say will have some interest to you. It's my first trip to Brazil, and well, I'm a student from Brazil and all sorts of things. I've never been here, and I must say it's an exciting place to be. And of course, IMPA itself has a very strong tradition. It's very exciting to be talking here today. So thank you very, very much. I want to tell you a story. It's not going to be very detailed in a mathematical sense. There's plenty of mathematics underneath it, but the talk today is going to stay, I hope, generally at a relatively high level. And I hope you'll find it accessible, at least a little bit. This thing doesn't work, so let's try this one. So, in a way, the story I want to tell you today is all about how you extend certain functions. Actually, functions that are quite important in the real world, and we'll come to them later. But before we start thinking about complex real-world functions, I want to just go back to some very abstract things about functions to remind you that there are issues to be sorted, because it's actually those sorts of issues that we have to sort to tackle the problems I'm really interested in. So I want to start really with a very, very basic thing that probably entertained the Greeks. We all know there's something called numbers, and probably the simplest numbers to think about are rational numbers. And we also know that there's a function called square root. And it sort of is that number which, when you multiply it by itself, gives you the number you started with. These things are all very elementary. But then, of course, the Greeks discovered that it isn't so straightforward, because actually, we only know about rational numbers. And what's the square root of 2? It can't be a rational number. And people begin to understand that actually there are a whole range of questions to be answered before you can really make sense of square root. And in the end, of course, it leads us to understanding the existence of all these other numbers, real numbers, that sort of fill in between the rational numbers and are so important to us. And it's this basic idea that just because you can see and touch and feel a function on a certain set of examples, it doesn't necessarily explain to you how you should go about defining it everywhere else. If you think about square root, doing that properly involved a huge amount of additional mathematics, and which we now take for granted, of course, but nonetheless, I think you will all agree that it is huge. So I want to give you a second example to sort of show you one way to think about these things, which again is very simplistic, but may help you. Suppose I wanted to extend this function, which is actually just sine 1 over x squared, to the and give it a value at 0, how would you do it? Well, actually, it's sort of obvious from this picture that if you want to give it a single value at 0, you're going to run into trouble because there are an enormous number of different values you might want to give it. And one easy way to explain that is to say, well, I was hoping to extend it from the half-open interval, from everything above 0 to 1, to the closed interval, including 0 to 1. And I have this set, which is the graph of my function. And I can close it, and I get a perfectly good closed set, because when you close sets, you get closed sets. But the set I get has the solid line here. And the trouble with that is that if you look at it, it's no longer the graph of a function. The graph of a function has the property that as a set, whenever you look along the x-axis, there should only be one value in the y-axis. And that clearly fails on this line. And what's going on here is that the graph of this function is not the closure of the graph of this function is not the graph of a function. And that's a very helpful way to think about things, particularly if they're unbounded or discontinuous, because this is a more robust concept than boundedness or continuity. But it's a more subtle question than it looks, because actually it's really about the topology we chose, the way we chose to think about things. It wouldn't actually be too hard to create a compact set in which the unit interval was dense so that you could extend that function. There are abstract machineries for closing up things in a way that leave all your functions continuous. But that's actually exactly not what I want to do, because these are generalized, complicated things that depend very much on the space of functions, or the exact functions you're looking at. The story I want to tell you is actually one where you do the obvious thing, and it doesn't work. You do the nearly obvious thing, and it works just fine, and you don't need to get into very complex, abstract ways of doing things. So actually, the functions I'm interested in are not points to points. They're rather more complex than that. They're things like my speech to you is an input, or a signal that's varying as the input. That's my x, so my gamma. And then I'm interested in a response, and that's my y. Now, that would probably all seem very abstract to you. So what I've tried to do is I've got a little program here, which I hope will allow us to get an idea of these things. Gone are the days when it will run directly out of the program. You see, here we have a ball, which we are hopefully able to see. And what's happening is this ball is being rolled along this path that you can see. If you think of the path as living on a table, or if you're a mathematician in the Lie algebra of the rotation group, and you are rolling the football, if you're an Argentinian or a Brazilian, along this path without letting it slip. This is clearly an example, a mathematician's example, not a real world example, of a message, a path, introducing information and having an effect on a nonlinear system, in this case, translating and rotating it. And the question I want you to think about is, first of all, how would you model this mathematically? It's actually not very difficult to model mathematically if you're a mathematician. You'd set up some differential equations, and they would actually be the differential equations of what's called Cartan development of a path in the Lie group into the Lie group of rotations, but that doesn't really matter. It's just that it's not too difficult to write down a mathematical model that relates this behavior of my input to the response of my sphere. But the problem with this perspective, and really the problem I'm interested in, is yes, this path is actually piecewise linear on a fine scale. If you look, it's made out of lots of little straight lines. So there's no ambiguity as to what happens. But suppose that happened on a very, very fine scale, and we were working on a much bigger scale, and what we wanted to know was the overall consequence of rolling my sphere along this path. How can I efficiently summarize this stream of data? Now you see we're beginning to move a little bit towards modern data science sort of things. How will we summarize this stream of data accurately so as to predict the effects on this ball? In fact, there's a cheating answer. You just give me the rotation of the ball, and then I don't need to know the path at all. So I don't want you to cheat. So I'd say I'm not going to tell you, for example, the radius of the ball. I want to understand in much more general sense what it is that I need to know about this data. How would I efficiently summarize this data so as to understand its consequences? And the surprising thing is that there is a sensible answer, and there's a sensible answer that's relatively insensitive to the system we're perturbing, which is slightly surprising if you take the view of an engineer who would probably say, well, you can't possibly understand anything until you understand the system it's affecting. And it turns out not to be quite true. So the question I'm trying to explain to you today, or the story I'm trying to tell you, really, is that there is a sensible way to answer the question I've just posed, and moreover, that sensible way has consequences, and I'll try and explain some of those consequences. So this theory, which was alluded to at the beginning, is what's called rough path theory. Not a very good name, because smooth paths are examples of rough paths. Rough paths are a generalization of the notion of smooth path. By the way, they're not a restriction of the notion of continuous path. But that's a bit complicated to explain. And they're absolutely about tackling this question I just asked you about, which is how you relate the behavior of your path to the response. Now, why did I start with this example of closed graphs? Why did I start by talking about extending functions? Well, because, as I explained to you in that picture, there is no difficulty rolling my ball along the path I gave you. It's a nice piecewise linear path. We have no difficulty understanding what we mean. But the problem is that function from piecewise linear paths into responses, rotations, effects, happens not to have a closed graph under the normal topology that everybody wants to use on paths. The normal topology everybody wants to use on paths is probably something like the uniform topology. If two paths are close together, they should have roughly the same response. It's not true. And the reason it's not true is actually that you can go around in circles. And if you go around in circles, then you will capture the non-linearity in the system, and you will force a rotation in the third direction of that sphere. And you can be uniformly close to the original path, you can be piecewise smooth, and still produce a substantially different effect. And this is actually quite radical, because it means that you're not going to describe that path in terms of the bit you can see. There's a bit you can feel that you cannot see. And that comes from all the complicated oscillations and rotations. And actually, the rough path theory is, to an extent, and I'll explain it loosely, about developing a language that lets you think about and understand comfortably, without a lot of paraphernalia, that phenomena. That just the bit you see doesn't tell you enough to predict what's going to happen. And if you think this is just maths, it's not. If you took the classical Brownian motion of Brown, you know, the pollen particle being bombarded by atoms and doing a random motion, if you gave that pollen particle a charge and you put it in a magnetic field, you would discover that it still did this erratic movement, but on a very fine scale it would be going around in circles, because the magnetic field induces a motion which is always perpendicular to the velocity. And so in practice it's exactly this sort of phenomena. You feed a Brownian motion in without a charge, you feed a Brownian motion in with a charge, and the two will produce entirely different effects on an external system. So anyway, there is a theory, the theory works, and it can do a fair number of different things, and I'm going to try and explain a few during my talk. But I wanted to explain to you as well that it actually depends on an enormous number of different areas of mathematics, in quite an exciting way, really. In some sense, it's very beholden on an English analyst, Young, and a paper he wrote in 1936 that appeared in Acta Mathematica, where he showed that you could, we all know that you can integrate a bounded variation function against a continuous function. That's what we normally call integration. But actually he showed, and he was interested in it for reasons of harmonic analysis, that if you have a function of bounded p-variation, and we won't go into what p-variation is, except that it allows you to have some more roughness. If you integrate a function of p-variation against a function of q-variation, where 1 over p plus 1 over q has to be either greater than or less than 1. The way that actually means that one gets smoother and the other gets rougher. Then actually you can also form the integrals, so long as they don't both have jumps at the same places. It works in a discontinuous case. So there's a class of integration that's a little different to classical integration, in that you make the inputs, the integrand, rougher, and you make the thing you're integrating smoother. And you can put those two together and get an integral just the same. But there's something in the proof of this argument that probably most people will skip over, which is very, very striking. Riemann integration, Lebesgue integration, they may slice the space up in different ways, but they all make a point of looking at things at a very, very fine scale and taking a limit in the fine scale. Well, Young did the same, but he did it in a very different way. He said, let's write down a finite, discrete approximation for what I mean by my integral. And then instead of making it finer, he proved a maximal inequality. He proved that you could never get too bad by doing that. And how did he prove it? He didn't prove it by going finer and finer. He went coarser and coarser. He said, well, actually, one of these bits of partition is smaller than all the others, pigeonhole principles. Let's join those two bits of partition together and make a bigger interval and compare what happens. And so he, one by one, removed points from the partition, coarsened the integration, and eventually got back to a trivial one-step approximation, and he bounds the error. Now, those of you who are analysts in the room will know, if you have a maximal inequality and something that converges on a dense set, it will converge for everything. And so here again, we have an extension idea. We know how to make the integration work for smooth paths, but because of this maximal inequality, we know how to make it work for all of them. But the really striking thing here is not that, I don't think. The really striking thing is, if you look at this proof, he worked from the top down and was able to show that he could get an answer as accurately as he liked from the top down without ever really touching the fine structure at all. And this is a crucial point. When we're dealing with complicated messages, we deal with them without ever going down to the individual pixels in the message. We know how to analyze things, to estimate things, without that complication. So this was a pretty important step. A second important step was the work of Katie Chen, and we'll come back to that, more than Young, which is why I spend so long on it now. And Katie Chen, a Korean mathematician who worked in Berkeley, he understood how to construct functions on paths. A path to me is some sort of function from time into a space. And as mathematicians, we should be interested in functions on those spaces. And he was, because he was trying to work out something called the Durham cohomology of loop space. And he understood how to write down functions on this space of paths and give us a nice basis for them. And that will turn out to be very important. The third thing that turns out to be very important is, again, that paths, and we'll have a picture about paths in a minute, paths are very, very non-commutative objects. They're just like sentences or words. And if you switch the order in which they happen, you can completely change their meaning. So to understand paths properly, you need to understand fully non-commutative free algebra. And it turns out that really is something that was rather well described in Bourbaki and also in the book of Reutenauer. And that turns out to be really quite important too. The next really important idea is due to Eli Stein. And this is the idea of what is a Lipschitz function. Now, again, if you are undergraduates, even an undergraduate probably thinks they know what a Lipschitz function is. And There are numerous important theorems about Lipschitz functions. The most interesting one for me here is the fact that actually Lipschitz function, this definition, makes sense if your function is only defined on a subset of the original space. It's a local idea. That seems obvious for points, but what Stein did, Stein realized that actually the correct way to define a Lipschitz function is a map from K, not into the reals, say, but actually, say, into the polynomials on RD. So a more complex object. And the idea is that at each point in your set, maybe only two points, you describe a function that is a sort of germ of your real function. So that's not how it should be. It should be like that. You describe a more complex object at each point in exchange for only defining it at points. And the complex objects are basically polynomials of a certain degree, Taylor approximations. But something rather special happens when you do this. If you think about polynomials correctly, you can think of them as functions or you can think of them as power series. A function is a polynomial if its nth derivative is identically zero. And that's nice because it doesn't specify which point you're expanding the power series. If you think of your description of your function in this way, then you use the same polynomial to approximate a polynomial at all these different points. Suddenly, the polynomials of degree k become constants. And you slow down your notion of how quickly functions change. And this is the key to making integration work. You can integrate Lipschitz functions against rough paths because by thinking of Lipschitz functions as these more complex objects, it doesn't matter that you don't or you do understand the detail of this complex object, but by thinking of those more complex objects, you can think of those complex objects as moving more slowly, and then you can use the Young integration to make sense of the whole integration. And finally, to close the whole thing off, and before we go on to something more basic, the reality is that you need set theory. Deep in all of the proofs of all the interesting theorems, there seems to be a little bit of real set theory that does not go away. Well, what can it do for you? We heard a little bit in the introduction that it has affected Martin's work on SPDEs. Basically, it's allowed us to make a much more robust and continuous definition of controlled differential equation. And using that, we've been able to tackle old questions and new. I don't really want to go into the detail too much because this is an introductory lecture. But I will finish the talk, I hope, with a little example of how it can be applied to machine learning and things like that, because I think this is something almost anybody can relate to. So I want to talk a little bit more carefully about what are paths and streams. What are these functions that we're trying to understand? I want to explain to you a very fundamental transform, a little like a Fourier transform, but it's not exactly like a Fourier transform, that is a very effective way of describing paths that goes back to that question I showed you. How the hell do you describe this complex path using mathematical language that doesn't worry about the detail and captures what you need and no more? And finally, I hope to give you a little example of a simple classification problem for machine learning with real data, which might give you some ideas as well. So for me, a path is simply sequential ordered data. And there are two ways to think about sequential ordered data. One of them is where you have a time scale, a clear time of evaluation. And the other is literally like a path where you see the route and you know the way to go, but nobody tells you how quickly or slowly you're going to walk along it. Paths turn up absolutely everywhere. This actually is just a piece of text. which I've translated into a path by taking the letters. And from each letter, which is a, I used the EBDIC or whatever coding for it, and I broke it up into four steps. There are four directions for each step, so that leaves us 256 different, if you like, path segments of length four, and that's a paragraph or two in the text. So I want you to get used to the fact that although we tend to write text in another way, if we're mathematicians, we can think of it as a path. You know, just as we can think of two apples as two apples, but we can also think of it as two apples. And paths are a very abstract, generic idea. Here's another path. This time, straightforward financial data. In this particular case, we have the evolution of a particular futures market in oil over, I think, a 15-minute interval. And what you see, which is sort of interesting in its own right, is the upper line that's moving a lot is the prices at which people are willing to sell. The lower line, which is more difficult to see, are the prices at which people are willing to buy. Notice this happens in a sequential way. And the solid line, just for your interest, really, is the last price at which something really sold. That's why. And what you notice is that actually, a bit like real estate agents, people are playing with prices much, much more often than they're actually buying and selling. But my point here is that this is just a path, and somebody is interested in its effect on their investment strategy. So an investment strategy, if you like, is a system that consumes market prices and produces profits and losses. So actually, people are quite interested in describing this path, looking for ways to think about it, capturing the features that are most important in it. So it's not just something that happens in text. In text, people are interested in capturing the main features. Interestingly, we ask our children to do it. It's quite common as homework to give a child the problem of taking a text and providing a précis, which is much shorter, but which captures the key effects. I would like to understand the mathematics of that, if I reasonably could. My models are much better posed and simpler than that, really. But I want to talk about mathematics, and to be talking about mathematics, I think one of the key things is we've got this abstract notion of a path. Most people can cotton on to that. We've seen the path with the football. We've seen the path, which is the financial data. We've seen the path, which is the text. And now, we need something quite precise and mathematical to hang on to help us develop a proper theory. And the thing I hang on to is the idea of a controlled differential equation. So gamma is my path. Y is the response. And at any given point in time, the direction of gamma is telling me how y should move according to where y is at the moment and according to the rules of the system, which are given by f. So that's the system, that's the ball, that's the response, and that's the input, the control, the path on the table. It's a very rich set of examples, and it arose in my interest in it originally came from probability theory, where typically y is something like a Brownian motion. And I wanted to understand how to make sense of that. Well, I want to look at a simple version of that. I want to look at the simple version where A is linear, so, and where gamma and y both live in vector spaces. So this object here actually has three hidden indices, an I that matches y, a j that matches this y, and a k that matches this object. And it's a sort of, not a matrix, it's a three-dimensional object. A linear map into matrices. And if we want to solve this differential equation, so I've replaced the complicated f by a simpler object, rich enough, by the way, to cope with the football. The football is development into a finite dimensional Lie group, and that will always be given by a finite dimensional linear problem. Well, there's a way to do this, which if you're not a mathematician, I apologize, but if you are, you should find quite simple, if a little tedious to write down in practice, and that is that you integrate the both sides. And so the the integral will be yt minus ys. And what do you get here? Well, the a is linear, so it comes outside the integral. And you get two parts. You write yt as two parts. You write yt as ys, and then as yt minus ys. And you can keep on going, and you iterate. And as you keep on iterating, you get a series like this. And this series is going to be very important to us. Because this series is actually magic. This series is exactly the remark that in some sense confounds the engineer who says, I can't understand how to model a response without really understanding the system. I can't just go and look at the noise or the inputs and learn something directly from that. Well, they're half right and they're half wrong. Because you really can study these two objects separately. There is a complete splitting between the influence of the system, which is done by computing powers of A, and the influence of the control or the path, which is given by these iterated integrals. These are quite complicated objects, but the point is they're different to these and can be studied separately. In fact, this collection of objects where you vary n, so you have the nth iterated integral, which is 1, you have the first iterated integral, which is the increment, the second iterated integral, the third iterated integral, fourth, and so on, get more and more complex, but they're a series, and if you treat the whole object as a single object, it's a very mathematical object. It's a map from paths into the tensor algebra, it's a homomorphism, the images are groups, so these are actually group-like elements. You can take logs, you can compute Lie elements if you know how to compute the basis for the free Lie algebra. You can get your hands on these things in real computational ways. This is a miracle, this formula, because of the way that it splits a very real world problem into two parts. It answers the question I asked about the football. This is a series of numbers just to do with the path. And we'll come back to the question in a minute of, well, how do you compute it? I mean, and how do we know it's only the first few terms that matter? All good questions, but questions we can answer. So, I want to talk about this object, this signature of our path. It's actually the collection of all the iterated integrals put together. It actually solves its own differential equation, and if you're a mathematician, you'll realize it's a fairly familiar differential equation, were it not for that nasty tensor product. If it were not for this nasty tensor product, and if that was scalar valued, we'd of course be working out the exponential function. But the reality is that there is a scalar product. This is fully non-commutative, which is just as well, because as I explained at the beginning, paths, words, sentences are very non-commutative. You really change the order of the pieces, and you'll change the effect completely. But nonetheless, this differential equation makes sense. It just happens to be taking its values in the free tensor algebra. And from this, it's actually rather easy to see that the image is a group, because it's easy to see that if you run the path backwards, you run this one backwards. So actually, it's easy to see that actually the running the path backwards gives you the inverse element of the group. It's also easy to see something called Chen's identity, which is that actually this map from path segments into tensors is a homomorphism. So the range is closed under multiplication, has inverses, so it's a group. But it's a transform. Gamma is a path. This is a sequence of numbers, or at least it's a tensor, and you can write it in terms of a canonical basis to produce a sequence of numbers. So it translates this continuous object into a discrete object. And it looks really horrible, all of these objects, and they are really horrible if you try and write them down, because they're exponentially rich. And so actually this is where mathematics is important. You'll find a lot of people in rough path theory actually get stuck at 3. And the reason they get stuck at 3 is that basically 3 to the n is a reasonable number, but n cubed is a reasonable number, n to the fourth is already getting very painful. And in fact, the only way to deal with a lot of these things is to do the algebra properly, and not everybody wants to do the algebra properly. But anyway, one of the interesting things about this signature, these coefficients, is they don't depend on the speed you go along the path. Whether you go quickly or slowly, you get the same answer. So I can reparameterize them at unit speed and do some analysis. If I take my nth term in the signature, but now reparameterize it at unit speed and then write the thing out in terms of derivatives, these all have modulus 1. So their product has modulus 1. So I can estimate the magnitude of this by getting rid of them all together, and then I'm just integrating over a simplex. A simplex whose side length is L. Well, what is the volume of a simplex? A simplex is you take n numbers and you say between 0 and L and you order them. Well, there are n factorial orders, and each order is a different simplex, a disjoint simplex, and they all go in the unit cube. So therefore, the integral of a simplex is simply 1 over n factorial. So actually, you have a good uniform estimate that says that nth term in the signature is never bigger than the length of the path, which is not necessarily a nice object, divided by n factorial. But if we come back to our formula that the response was given by the sum of these objects, or these objects contracted with these objects we know are going like L to the n over n factorial, but these are only growing geometrically. So we see that once we go bigger than the norm of A times L, these terms collapse and control everything, and really the response is controlled by the first L norm A of these terms, which can be a lot of terms, but it's a very finite set of terms, but nonetheless. So it tells you very explicitly that I can control the response of that path to every Lie group whose norm of its map is less than R, by at most RL layers in the signature. In fact, much less if I'm allowed to project into the Lie algebra, because that will collapse everything down from the free Lie algebra. But if I want to do it generically for all of those groups at once, then I have to have the whole lot. But this is actually quite exciting. Again, it comes with that magic. It tells you that really there are uniform estimates that tell us I only need to know these terms to predict the response to a certain accuracy. And I suggest to you that at the start of the talk today, and maybe still, you'd have had no idea how to solve that problem. So I want to give you a toy example now to show how you can use these things. I want to give you a toy example which allows you to understand that this stuff can be practical and can actually allow you to avoid theory in some situations. So let's suppose we have a dynamical system. Here, the dynamical system is just going to be a differential equation driven by a two-dimensional path with a one-dimensional output. And it's not linear, just to make life a bit more fun. And we're going to observe lots of inputs and lots of responses. And we're going to try and learn how to learn the relationship. So we deep down know the maths here, but there are lots of situations where you don't. So if you want a concrete situation, which I would love to do, which is more complicated than this, is that there is a building in Los Angeles where they have microphones on every floor, and you can monitor the input, which is, if you like, the movement of the basement where the ground moves, and you can monitor the response of the system. And what you'd like to do is simply learn how to predict the relationship between the inputs, the movement of the Earth, and the response of the building. Because modeling a really complicated object like a building is pretty hopeless. Learning it is a much more likely to be a successful activity. So anyway, here is a very naive version of that, done by one of my postdocs, Nihao. And she took 800 independent noises. She solved the differential equations using the sort of standard numerical method you would use for stochastic differential equations. And she looked at this function. But the point is, she used the fact that this function should be, we've just seen actually, a linear combination, and we'll come back to why this one's linear, because it's a non-linear differential equation. A linear combination of those terms, the signature. That signature unravels non-linearity. If I have a polynomial function of the signature, for various technical reasons, because we're only looking at group-like elements embedded in the enveloping algebra and the full tensor algebra, a polynomial function can be always replaced by a linear function. So I should be able to write my response as a linear combination of terms in the signature of x. And I should be able to learn a linear function, because most people know how to fit a straight line to a straight line using least squares. So that's the basic idea. We have inputs, we have outputs. We know that we have a good basis of functions of our inputs, and we're going to try and write the function we're looking at as a linear combination of them. And this is the basis for most of unsupervised learning. And here is the reality of it. And it's surprisingly successful. So on the training set, you expect to be able to fix things up. So we're able, I think we looked at the first three or maybe the first four iterated integrals here. And you've basically can find a linear combination of them. Each of the iterated integrals is a real valued function on parts. You try to find a linear combination of them that matches your observed data. And you do pretty well. But the interesting thing is that you now take a completely new set of data. If you'd overfitted, this would be all over the place. But the fact is that it's not overfitted at all. And you do just as well with the new data as you did with the old data. In other words, you can learn the behavior of the function without any theory. You don't need to calculus or anything like that. You have the inputs, you have the outputs, you can measure the response, you can match it to your input, your prototype functions, find the right linear combination of them, and that really works. Now, wouldn't it be nice if you could do something similar with the buildings and be able to predict how the building responded to inputs from learning what happens in non-destructive situations? Now, you wouldn't be able to do this properly because as you hit a building harder, of course, the modeling goes wrong and different things start to happen. But you might be able to find the edge of the limiting behavior, the limiting edge of where it would stay within good bounds. So the basic idea of unsupervised learning, and you can call it kernel methods, you can call it all sorts of things, is to try and introduce some functions, some basic features, they would call them, of your underlying data, in our case, paths, and hope that your function, your observed data, can be represented as a linear combination of these basic features. And then there are lots of ways to find that combination, and you can handle noise and all sorts. But there's a problem with this approach. And the problem of this approach is there's no real reason, if you take a general collection of functions of your data, that they should span, that they should be rich enough to be able to write your average function as a combination of them. Notice, though, that in the most interesting cases we're used to, something like that is true. So we're very used to the fact that we can write smooth functions, at least locally, as linear combinations of monomials, which is the same story in the abelian case. We're also quite used to the fact we can write things as sums of trigonometric polynomials. So why should we be able to write things as sums of iterated integrals? Well, for much the same reason, actually. If we think about how we construct these iterated integrals, so here we are, we've got the complicated object, which is this tensor object. We can produce real valued functions out of it by projecting each of these vectors onto a coordinate. And we see that we have an indexed family, indexed by the dual tensor algebra if you really want it, an indexed family of real valued functions on paths. I call them coordinate iterated integrals. And a basis for them is given by choosing words. So this gives you a finite collection, our coordinate iterated integrals, of real-valued functions, of features of our path. Now, why are they rich enough? Well, you'll have heard probably of something called the Stone-Weierstrass theorem, which tells you that at least on compact sets, if we have an algebra of functions which separates the points, then that is going to be dense in the uniform topology. So having an algebra structure is important. And the interesting fact here is that if I take two of these coordinate integrals and multiply them together, so that's taking the product of these functions, then the magic is, again, this is another bit of magic, you can rewrite it as a sum. This is trivial magic, but very important. It's this fact I was telling you before, that polynomials unravel into linear functions. And the proof is very easy. If you take the product of two integrals over simplexes, then by Fubini's theorem, it's the integral over the product space. And if you think of the product of two simplexes, a little bit of thought will tell you that actually you're going to get the integral over all ways of interleaving the first set of ordered variables with the second set of ordered variables, what's called a shuffle product. So you've actually, every way of doing that interleaving is producing an integral over a different simplex, and they're all disjoint. So actually you, just by that geometric intuition that the product of two simplexes can be rewritten as a sum of disjoint simplexes, you've understood why this objects form an algebra. You multiply two together, you can write the combination as a linear sum of basic elements, just as you can with trig functions. And that makes them dense. That makes them rich enough. That means that the expected value of the signature tells you the measure on the signatures, and all sorts of wonderful things. So they form a basis for the signatures. Now, what is not quite obvious is that the signatures are rich enough to determine the paths. That's a fact, but it's a fact that needs a certain care to it. Most of you will have heard about Fourier series. Fourier series determine a continuous, or determine a function on the circle, don't they? Well, they don't, actually. If you think about it, Fourier series only determine functions on the circle up to Lebesgue null sets. And, in fact, it was a big step forward for Fourier analysis when Lebesgue did Lebesgue integration, because all of a sudden people could be quite precise about the sense in which a Fourier series can actually characterize as a function. And the same is true here. There is an appropriate class of null sets. It's nothing to do with Lebesgue null sets. Is to do with tree-like paths that undo everything they do. But there's a very precise notion of null set, and it's a theorem that modulo those null sets, every path has a unique signature, and moreover, that gives you a group of paths. So it's a fact that you can take two paths of finite length, and you can concatenate them, and that actually turns out to be a group object, providing you have the right equivalence relation. And the point is that actually the two paths might actually undo each other for a while. And that would be called having a tree-like piece. And in fact, you can prove that every path of finite length has a shortest version with no tree-like pieces, and that they form a group. You multiply two paths together, you rub out any tree-like pieces, and that makes the bounded variation paths a group. And that's exactly what signatures measure. So I don't know what time is doing, but I guess I must be running out of it if I've not...
10 minutes.
10 minutes. Good. So I am almost perfect. So I want now to show you this in practice. Okay, so what I have here is a program written some time ago now. What I have somewhere is a pen that will write on the screen. And the point is that what it does is it translates your path into this sequence of numbers and gives you some intuition. Now, there's two ways to represent the path easily. One is as a signature. This is this very complex object, which has a lot of redundancy in it, which is why non-linear functions unravel into linear functions. So in many situations, for example in the machine learning, this is the object you want to use, because the redundancy allows you to turn every problem into a linear problem, and we know how to solve linear problems. But if you're just trying to understand it, it's often easier to take the logarithm, which has no redundancy, and then you can sort of see what's going on a little bit. And I'm going to mainly look at the log signature, and at the end I'll show you how... Well, maybe I'll do that first, actually. It's on the signature at the moment. If I draw a path... No, that's the log signature, so let's actually do the signature first. If I draw the signature of the path, you see, it produces masses and masses of terms. And there's a lot of redundancy in these. I'll come back. These, by the way, means this is the tensor product. I mean, these numbers here refer to the basis elements in the space. And so this is the coefficient, minus 4 times 10 to the 7 times E2, tensor E2, tensor E2, tensor E1. Because we're in two-dimensional space. But anyway, it doesn't much matter what those are. Here, the only thing to notice is that actually you can take a real path and produce a real sequence of numbers, which actually is useful for unraveling functions on paths. That's all you need to take away from this. And in fact, I started making progress with other people on this when we introduced a Python tool called SigTools, which does exactly that. And because people didn't have to understand tensor algebras or anything else and just got the idea that the function they're interested in should be approximately a linear function of this matrix of numbers, that was something they could work with, and I think it helped quite a lot in making this stuff a little bit more accessible. But I want to talk to you today about it from a more mathematical perspective, so I'm going to take the log. And now we have far fewer terms to describe the same thing. And I want to try and help you understand what the first few terms are. Because as I said, there's this theorem by Ben Hambly and myself which says it completely describes the path. And in fact, there's a more recent version of the theorem which says every rough path is also completely described by a sequence like this. But what does it capture? So this is the top-down description. I'm not going to get involved in the fine detail of my path. I'm going to look at the biggest pieces of the path. So let's just draw a straight line to start with and understand the first couple of terms. So actually this moves 160 units horizontally and it moves minus 5 units vertically. I think going up is negative. So you see the first few two terms just describe the increment of the path. So this was a text. It would be just describing the word count. The number of words the number of words A, the number of words bush, and so on. Okay? And it doesn't record the order. So if it had bush and likes, it could be likes bush, or it could be bush likes. And they, of course, have completely different meaning. On the other hand, the second term gets a little bit more interesting. So the second term actually is the area between the path and a chord. So you see, if it goes that way, you see that we have a positive area of 15,914 units. If, on the other hand, we went the other way, it has a negative one of roughly the same magnitude, 17,000. So it captures very much the area, the order in which these events happen. If you want to think about it, imagine that for some time you go in the x direction. Sorry, the y direction. And then you go in, you go sometime in the y direction, sometime in the x direction. So that gives you a positive area. But if, on the other hand, it happened the other way around, you get a completely different sign. Now, this also explains brutally why there are situations where wavelets are no good for handling two-dimensional data. Because this interchange between x changing and y changing can happen very, very quickly over a very short period of time. Nothing much can happen for a very long time. Then a piece of news comes in and somebody trades. Or perhaps it's the other way around. Nothing happens for a very long time, period of time. And suddenly somebody trades and then the piece of news comes in. One way round gives positive area. One way round gives negative area. One way round is an investor reacting. The other is an investor doing insider trading. There's quite fundamental differences between them, but from the perspective of wavelets or something like that, you wouldn't capture that without capturing things down to a frequency level that is short enough to capture the individual syncing of these two signals. And that's the point. This is actually looking at the data in terms of the order in which events happen, not the time at which they happen. It's not using time as an interlocutor to get us to order of events. It's measuring them directly. And if you want to understand, again, one thing I'm quite fond of as a little narrative for this would be understanding Shakespeare plays. In Britain, we have a concept of a play which is a tragedy and a play which is a comedy. A tragedy is a play which starts off happy and ends up awful. And a comedy is something which starts off awful, but everything is put right at the end and ends up happy. And you see, if we measure every word that's awful and we make a horizontal movement, and every word that's happy and we make a vertical movement, we see that the area of this path exactly translates into whether it's a comedy or a tragedy. And this is the point. We are looking at this sequence of events in a very macro way. And the third term and the fourth term just give more and more refined issues. So the third term will easily tell you the difference between that and that. And so on. But they have opposite signs if you look up at the top. But I mean, so the point is that it's a theorem that these, over, if you take all of them, they give you a complete description of the path. But from a practical point of view, they are also useful, I would say very useful, in distinguishing things. And I just want to finish, if I have time. With a little bit about, how much do I have? 2 minutes? Perfect. Okay. So in these last 2 minutes, I just want to give you a real example of classification for financial data. So the thing we were interested in was, could we tell the difference between the times of day in a certain market just by looking at the stream of data? And what we did is we took the times of day. We normalized out all the obvious reasons, so it wasn't a trivial problem. We took the times of day. Each of them produces a load of paths representing the change in everything over the 30 minutes. We computed their signatures, and we tried to fit a function. We tried to fit the function that was 1 at one time and 0 at the other time. This is a standard way to do classification. You know to learn classification. You know that which time of day they were. You say the function is 1 here and 0 here, and you try and fit a function that does it, and you use it on the new data to work out the time of day. And that's exactly what you see here. So on the left, you try to write as a linear combination of signatures the function that is 0 at one time and 1 at the other, and you see it's not perfect by any means, but it doesn't do badly, and it separates the data out rather well. And then you try it on completely fresh data, and you're absolutely delighted because this very naive method is substantially separating out the real data. And the RSC curves that, and you can visualize it as well. And thank you very, very much indeed for listening so far.